Hello guys, today we'll talk about the male reproductive system. So first up, let's talk about testes. First up, we have the blood vessels and nerves. Now these ones, of course, compose the pampiniform venous plexus. And why do we have that? Well, the point of this venous plexus is to maintain a colder temperature. And this is, of course, because in order to produce semen, to produce sperm, we need to have a lower temperature. The average human body temperature is 36.6 to 37 degrees of Celsius. And of course, in the production of sperm, we need a lower temperature to 34 degrees. So the human body, of course, in order to adjust to this necessity, to this temperature need, we have the, that's why actually it exposes the testes to the outer temperature outside of the body, practically speaking. And of course, also provides this venous plexus that helps the testes, of course, sweat more. And as a consequence, cold the blood, lower the temperature of the blood. And as a consequence, reach the lower temperature of 34 degrees Celsius. So this is the first that we should discuss about the differences, the specific needs of this organ. So of course, we know that the sperm actually is produced in the testes, and specifically, we're going to see exactly which structures constitute that. So first up, we're going to have the outer layer, the visceral and parietal layer of tunica vaginalis. In this case, again, it's typical mesothelium that produces this viscous fluid that reduces the friction in many ways. The inner capsule is going to be the tunica albuginea. This is dense connective tissue that covers up the whole testis, the inner testis in this specific case. And as you can see in this picture, this is a lobulated structure. Specifically, the testis contains this many, many seminiferous tubules that are actually highly, highly coiled within the tubules, within interspersed with connective tissue. And specifically, the whole length of all of the seminiferous tubules, if you put them and line them into one specific segment, this is going to end up into 250 meters of seminiferous tubules. This is a massive area and a massive length. So of course, in order to be able to compress all of this tissue within these lobules, of course, this results into a very highly coiled structure. So the seminiferous tubules is the area where we have the production of sperm. And of course, after sperm is being produced, we have to move it towards the mediastinum testis, specifically to the rete testis, and specifically in this area. Rete means actually network. And here we're going to have the production of seminiferous tubules of sperm. It's going to pass by the straight tubules, reaching the rete testis, and in the end, lead up to the epididymis. Now, the function of epididymis is to store and to mature the sperm. So we'll discuss this physiological details in just a bit. So again, this is the whole structure I told you before. In the lobules, we're going to have the seminiferous tubules through the straight tubules to the rete testis, and then in the end leading up to the epididymis. So let's start talking about the septum and the lobule specifically. So within this area of the seminiferous tubules, again, this is a tubule. This is just simply imagined as a tube that that actually has different cells that we should discuss and mention the function of each. So this is the functional unit, the seminiferous tubule of the testes. Now, the first cell we're going to see in the outer area is going to be the muscle cell, this myoid cell. This myoid cell, of course, as the name suggests, is a contractile cell and allows the very slow contraction of the very weak contraction of the tubule, and allows, of course, for the sperm to move from the tubule towards the epididymis. This is the logic. Now, we're going to find three more different types of cells in this case. The spermatogonia, right here, exactly right here, the Sertoli cells, and the interstitial cells, also called Leydig cells. So let's start talking about specifically the Sertoli cells and what is the importance of the Sertoli cells. So the Sertoli cells, in fact, play a role in protection, support, and nutrition. What does this mean? Because all of the seminiferous tubules is actually an area that is very tightly controlled when it comes to environment. And of course, it doesn't allow the expression and the exposure of the cells of the spermatogonia in this case to the body in order to prevent any immune-related reaction towards the spermatogonia, and of course the whole process, which is very, very sensitive. So the Sertoli cells practically encircle and cover up completely the area of the that is ex- that exposes spermatogonia to the interstitium. Now, of course, Sertoli cells also play a role in phagocytosis. In this case, we'll see the phagocytose, specifically residual bodies that come from the process of spermatogenesis and spermogenesis. Furthermore, the Sertoli cells play a role in synthetizing the androgen binding protein. This is a specific protein that practically binds testosterone and make it practically converge into this small area, which is a very, very controlled area. And this, as a consequence, has that it increases the concentration of testosterone, because concentration, of course, is a unit that is, of course, mass divided by volume. So if we increase the specific amount of testosterone in this specific closed volume, you increase the concentration. This is the point of this protein, in fact. One more function is that it releases water from the interstitium or from the vasculature towards the seminiferous tubules. And as a consequence, because we have this movement of water, we also this water carries the sperm from the seminiferous tubules towards the epididymis. Furthermore, it actually also secretes inhibin. Now, this molecule, in fact, ceases and reduces the amount of production of FSH, the follicular stimulating hormone. So this is practically a feedback mechanism to stop producing FSH. Now, one more and last activity of the endocrine activity of the Sertoli cells is that it produces the anti-Müllerian hormone. This is important because in this case, if we don't have the absence of this of the anti-Müllerian hormone, we're going to have the development of a female ductular system. So this is again the differences between male and female when it comes to hormonal situations. Now, the most important feature of Sertoli cells is going to be easily seen in this picture and in this. Because the Sertoli cells form the blood testis barrier. In fact, the blood testis barrier is the most tight barrier in the human body because of the many, many different, let's say, unique characteristics in glycoproteins and contents of the spermatogonia. We have to prevent any immune attack in this case. So we actually facilitate this this process and this, let's say, capacity of the spermatogonia by having this very, very tight barrier, which is, of course, constituted and made from the Sertoli cells. Specifically, the Sertoli cells have a very, very tight junction and practically cover up in layers in the different phases of the spermatogenesis. So to clear out the confusion, spermatogenesis is the process of starting from spermatogonium and reaching the spermatids, and the spermiogenesis is the maturation of spermatid to the mature sperm to the very end of the case, such as exactly in this picture right here. So exactly this is the structure. We're going to have the tight junctions from the Sertoli cells. The Sertoli cells are bound on the basal membrane, of the seminiferous tubules, and the whole process is, of course, the maturation and the differentiation, the meiosis and mitosis of the spermatogonium in this case, to start from the 46 pairs to the haploid system with the 23 chromosomes. You should be able to be familiar with the two terms: basal compartment, which is, of course, let's say the initiating point where the spermatogonium still has a sort of contact with the basal membrane, and exactly beneath that, the adluminal compartment, we're going to have no contact to the basal membrane. So we're going to start seeing in the spermatid. These are the two pictures that differentiate the spermatogenesis to spermogenesis. In fact, the spermatogenesis stops practically in this layer after reaching the last stage of the spermatids. So during spermiogenesis, we're going to have the formation of the acrosomal cap, the flagella, and of course the formation of the residual body. Now, this whole spermiogenesis has specific phases. First up, we're going to have the phase which is the Golgi phase. The Golgi phase will be the initiating point of the development of the acrosomal cap. Now, specifically, why do we call it Golgi phase? Well, because parts of the Golgi apparatus practically fuse different particles of the different granules of the Golgi apparatus will actually fuse to form this acrosomal cap. Now, this acrosomal cap, with the next phase, is going to be the cap phase, where it's going to be the formation of the acrosomal cap. The acrosomal cap contains two different enzymes, acrosin and hyaluronidase. Now, hyaluronidase, of course, along with acrosin, play a role into the destruction of the zona pellucida in the female system, of course. And this is, of course, this is one of the major processes that allow the sperm to penetrate and induce the formation of the zygote in the end. So this is the first stage. The second stage is going to be the other part in this case is going to be the formation of the flagellum. The flagellum is going to be developing, going to be continuously developing throughout their whole phases, and in the after the stage of the capsid, we're going to have the formation of the acrosome phage. And after the acrosome phase, we're going to have the maturation phase. So the point in this whole situation is that we have to form the acrosome, which is one of the most important functional points of the sperm. And of course, it's going to be the loss of the excess cytoplasm that forms the residual body, and lastly the flagellum, which facilitates the movement of the sperm in this case. So the Sertoli cells play a role exactly into the formation of the blood testis barrier and facilitate different layers throughout the whole procedure of spermatogenesis and spermiogenesis. This is again the same picture, the same exact point. We're going to see exactly the myoid cells, also called pretubular, but typically heard. The more common term is myoid. The basal lamina, again, we're going to find the Sertoli. You can see that the Sertoli cell expands from the very basal membrane to the very, very top of the whole state of the whole seminiferous tubules mucosa. So this is exactly the structure. And lastly, one very important thing to mention and to actually really appreciate the amazing nature of Sertoli cells is that they're able to facilitate the movement of a lot of continuous cells at continual spermatogonia. What do I mean when I say continual? Well, because even after the whole mitosis phase, we're going to still maintain the intercellular bridges. So this connection, this contact, these bridges are still maintained throughout the whole procedure of both spermatogenesis and spermogenesis. So in this case, the Sertoli cells is able to facilitate the whole movement of multiple cells from one layer to the other. So we can see how flexible these tight junctions of the Sertoli cells and the connection between them can actually be, and actually be able to facilitate the different stages and different layers at the same time. So let's visualize the whole structure in the macroscope. Now, this is exactly the structure of the testis. Again, the outer point is the connective tissue. This is the tunica albuginea. And if we zoom in, we should start seeing the whole epithelium and the whole seminiferous tubules. Now, one important cell we didn't discuss is the Leydig cell, this interstitial cell. We're going to first see exactly the seminiferous tubules and then talk about exactly about this cell. So here we can see exactly in this the many layers that we can find the Sertoli cells, the spermatogonia, and so on and so on. Now, it's not that easy to distinguish between the Sertoli cells and the cells of the spermatogonium under different and the different, of course, evolutionary phases. The easiest thing to do is, of course, is to follow the whole cytoplasmic process from the base to the very top, and this is exactly the easiest way to distinguish the one from the other. Also, this is, for example, this is a Sertoli cell. How do we know? Because it's actually very tall. We can see the proportional size of the nucleus to the cytoplasm, and it's important to notice that all the stem cells, of course, all the cells that are highly active, mitotically speaking, are going to have big and very, very vivid nuclei stainings, and of course, bigger nuclear to cytoplasm ratio. So this is the second way we can distinguish the Sertoli cells from the spermatogonia. And of course, surrounding, we're going to find the myoid cells, exactly right here. These are the myoid cells that, of course, have the contractile function. And in between the different seminiferous tubules, we're going to find the interstitial cells, also called Leydig cells. Now, the Leydig cells have one function, which is to produce testosterone. This is, of course, a function that is being controlled by the amount of luteinizing hormone in the human blood. And of course, because of the function of the LH to the Leydig cells, we're going to have the production of testosterone. So exactly, this is the structure. This is exactly what we need to talk about. And of course, you can actually see that this of course, between and interspersed with the structure, interstitium of the seminiferous, we're going to find, of course, vessels and other connective tissue in between the interstitium.